I would like to fight Adonis Chickenson.
Adonis Chickens, Chickens, Chickens.
I would like to fight Adonis Chickenson.
Chickens, Chickens, Chickens.
I would like to
Bring me one of those chickens. And you'll take two chickens.
You're a chicken!
I am not a chicken!
Bring me one of those chickens.
Chicken.
You'll take two
chickens.
You're a chicken! I am not chicken!
Bring me one of those chickens.
Adonis Chickens.
Adonis Chickens. Chickens.
Chickens.
Am I the only one who wonders whether or not Sergey Kovalev knows the difference between a chicken and a duck?
I would like to fight Adonis Chickenson.
Adonis Chickenson, who is also here ringside.
This is Rummy's Corner.
Rummy's Corner.
I'm gonna have to eat every fucking chicken in this room.
And just a quick note on the whole Kovalev-Stevenson thing. I think the main reason we're not getting the fight, I know that after they were co-featured on a bunch of bouts on HBO, they were supposed to have a showdown together, and Stevenson went over to Showtime where he thought he could get more money, and then I think there was another time where there was a call for a purse bid that Duver or Main Events backed out of. I don't really place blame on the feet of either fighter necessarily. I just think it's one of those unfortunate things where politics prevented a logical fight from coming together. So in boxing, funny things can happen sometimes, and I think the case involving Sergey Kovalev is particularly interesting, because it wasn't that many years ago that nobody really knew who Sergey Kovalev was. He hadn't broken into the mainstream, he wasn't a well-known commodity. Then he hooked up with Main Events. I believe Kathy Duva was scouting him out when he had his rematch against Darnell Boone, who had dropped him the first time the two met. And Duva was impressed and signed him right away. And you have to remember, for Main Events, this was back at a time, this was in June 2012, I believe, when Kovalev had defeated Boone in the rematch. But it wasn't that long ago, it was about a year earlier when Zab Judah had lost his unification bout against Amir Khan for the 140-pound title. And then a couple months later that same year, Tomas Adamek had been badly, badly outclassed against the oversized Vitaly Klitschko. So at the time, Judah and Adamek were the two main attractions that Main Events brought to the table. And when those two lost their big fights in 2011, it looked like Main Events was out of star power, and then along comes this guy Kovalev they took a chance on that nobody really knew a lot about. And Kovalev did well. He strung off a number of impressive victories, and he looked good. He beat guys like Nathan Cleverly, and he had a couple of good wins in there. And then where his real coming out party came, where he really proved his worth and how good of a fighter he was in his fight with Bernard Hopkins. Now, some of his critics and detractors won't give Kovalev a lot of credit for his performance against Hopkins, citing his age. After all, Hopkins was 49 years old. I think he was just a couple of months shy of 50. But I ain't buying that. That was still Bernard Hopkins in there. This was a guy that never got beaten up inside the ring, and he'd never even really been outclassed. He had a clear loss to Roy Jones early in his career in the early 90s, but then all of his other losses that came after that, his two losses to Jermaine Taylor, his loss to Joe Calzaghe, those were controversial losses, and then the first draw with Pascal was controversial. And then he did clearly lose, I thought, against Chad Dawson, but again, he was competitive. It wasn't like he got blown out. And what Sergey Kovalev did to Hopkins was truly, in my mind, a marvel, because Hopkins, even at his advanced age, I would have favored him almost against anybody at 175, 168, that range. That's how good of an operator I still think Hopkins was. So then you have another group of people that think that Kovalev carried Bernard Hopkins for 12 rounds, and I ain't buying that either. I don't think that was the case at all. I don't think that Sergey was holding back, and I think that Hopkins, after feeling Kovalev's power in the first round, I think he realized he had to try to take this kid and got into deep waters and exploit any opportunities he found. And to Kovalev's credit, he did an incredible job maintaining the distance, and he prevented Hopkins from doing anything. Hopkins was biding his time, waiting for Kovalev to make mistakes, and it didn't happen. So then I think the strategy became to take him to deep waters. I don't think Kovalev had ever been past seven rounds at that point, and Kovalev didn't tire. He had a consistent pace and fought a very disciplined fight behind a great fight plan, and he stuck with it, and he dominated Hopkins like we've never seen Hopkins dominated before. Hopkins had mistakenly believed, I think he cited Kovalev as being somebody that had Frankenstein legs, as he put it. But I think Hopkins, I don't know if he really believed that going into the match, but I think once they were in the ring, he realized very quickly early on that this was not the case. That Kovalev knew where to be and how to best utilize his strengths. He might not be the flashiest guy out there. He might not have the best set of skills, but the set of skills he has is optimized to maximize his utmost efficiency. It's just a good blend of skills for his style with his tremendous punching power. You know, the rise of Sergey Kovalev is really something that came out of nowhere. And now this week, earlier in the week, some news came out with him about two fights that he has signed. And one of them is his next bout against Isaac Chalemba, which is a fight, I think it's happening in Russia in July. Chalemba's no pushover. This is another good opponent that Kovalev will be taking. He could have definitely taken a softer touch as his tune-up prior to Ward, but he wanted a good fighter, a good opponent out there in Russia, and he got one in Chalemba. I don't think Chalemba's going to win. I don't personally give him much of a chance, but that's more a credit to Kovalev than a dismissal of the qualities that Chalemba brings to the table, which in some ways I guess could prepare him for Ward, in the sense that Chalemba has a bit of a spoiler style, and in that sense, him and Ward have something in common. And then, of course, the bigger news is that he will be fighting Andre Ward in November. And Ward is supposed to take another fight later this summer. I don't think any opponent has been named. It's been rumored that he'll be facing Shabransky. Vyacheslav Shabransky, another good fighter, maybe on the level of Barrera, maybe a little better or a little worse, depending on your personal preference. I think he's undefeated with 16 fights or so. But there's no guarantee that Ward's going to fight that guy. He's just a name that I've heard thrown out there as a possibility. So I believe that Kovalev will beat Chalemba and probably do so impressively with another good stoppage. And I'm sure Ward will have a fight sometime in the summer. I don't know if it'll be against Shabransky or not, but whoever it's against, the hope is that they both look pretty good, neither of them suffers a bad cut or an injury of any sort. And then we get the showdown that I'm extremely fired up for personally. I don't think there's a better fight out there that could be made than a fight between Kovalev and Ward. I know a lot of people like to make these comparisons between Ward and Hopkins, and I see it. There are a lot of comparisons that can be made. And in a lot of ways, I view Andre Ward, I think of him as a younger version of an older Bernard Hopkins. And what I mean by that is, he doesn't remind me of a young Bernard Hopkins, because young Bernard Hopkins fought nothing like he did in the later parts of his career, where he had to compensate for his deteriorating reflexes and athleticism and be more of the craftier guy we've known over the last 10 years or so. But I think that Ward fights a little bit more like an older Hopkins, but he has the youth and all the athleticism that comes with the youth on his side. One of the big differences I see between Hopkins and Ward personally is that over the last bunch of years, Hopkins really hasn't had a whole lot of a left hand. And that's not to say he doesn't have a left hand, but his jab and his left hook aren't something that he utilizes the way he could in his younger years. And Hopkins, his bread and butter punch is the right hand. He likes the right hand, he likes to tie guys up, he likes to do infighting, but he likes to look for ways to set up that right hand and find ways to land it by walking guys into traps and controlling the distance in ways he can maneuver them to be where he wants to be, something he had difficulty doing against Kovalev. But what Ward brings to the table is that left hand. He might not have as good of a right hand, but Ward's left hook might be one of the best left hooks in boxing today. And Ward can work behind a good jab, and Ward has a good right hand. His right hand's a bit of a mystery. He threw it a lot against Paul Smith, who really wasn't in Ward's class, but he didn't seem to use it as much to me in his fight, his more recent fight against Sullivan Barrera. But in any case, Ward's left hand and his control of the distance and the fact that he's younger, I see the comparisons between him and Hopkins, but only to a certain extent. One of the things I think that makes this Ward-Kovalev fight special, you look at Pacquiao-Mayweather, and that's a fight I think most people would agree happened 5 years too late. But Kovalev and Ward right now are both in their primes. They're both at the top of their games, and in my opinion, these guys both have the goods. I think they would be competitive in any era in the 168 to 175 range. And I know 168 is a newer division, but I think they'd be competitive against any guys in that range in history. Am I saying they'd be the best? Am I saying they'd beat a guy like R.G. Moore? No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying they couldn't possibly beat him, but I wouldn't favor either of those guys against the old mongoose. But the point I'm making is, they would still be good wins for the old mongoose had these two fought in his era. So I think Ward and Kovalev are good enough that they would have succeeded in any era. The fact that we're gonna get this fight in November, if everything goes according to plan with their two upcoming tune-ups, that would be grand. I mean, I don't think there's a better fight in boxing that could be made right now. And I really believe that the winner of a fight between Sergey Kovalev and Andre Ward would produce an undisputed pound-for-pound king, a true heir in the post-Floyd Mayweather era. I can't wait to see it. I really believe whoever emerges the winner in this one is the pound-for-pound best in the sport. This is Rumsfeld. Thank you for tuning in. Please stay tuned for more episodes in the future. And if you like the video, please subscribe to my channel. Thank you. And I'd also like to give a special thanks to CST80 from the ESB message boards, our resident expert on Sergey Kovalev. Thank you for your help. See you all soon.